वेलकम टू ISC प्लस वन हिस्ट्री क्लास. वी आर गोइंग टू कंटिन्यू विद द सेम टॉपिक लेसन टू एमर्जेंस ऑफ कलोनियल इकोनॉमी. फर्स्ट वील अंडरस्टैंड द ऑब्जेक्टिव्स ऑफ द लेसन. टू डिस्कस द डेवलपमेंट ऑफ मीन्स ऑफ ट्रांसपोर्ट एंड कम्युनिकेशन. द प्लान फॉर बिल्डिंग द रेलवेज. डिस्रप्शन ऑफ ट्रेडिशनल इकोनॉमी. द रेवेन्यू पॉलिसीज इंक्लूडिंग द परमानेंट सेटलमेंट, रेउतवाड़ी एंड महलवाड़ी सिस्टम. डिवेलपमेंट ऑफ मॉडर्न इंडस्ट्रीज and colonial forest policies and its impact on local communities. In last session, we had already discussed about the development of means of transport and communication. We had already discussed about the building of railways. And in this session, we will discuss about disruption of traditional economy. First, we will go through the new terms. Disruption, a major disturbance. Saturated, flooded with. Slump, falling of economy by large amount. Lobby, a group of people who try to influence politicians to do or not do something. Calico, a type of cotton cloth and usually it is white in color. Deindustrialization, the reduction of industrial activity in a region. Infiltration, a person who secretly becomes part of a group in order to get some information. And the last term is home charge, the interest of India's external debt and the payments of the salaries and pensions of British officials. During the Mughal period, India was regarded as a storehouse of handicrafts, cotton and silk products. That was the time when British entered India during Jahangir's time period. Industrial Revolution took place in England. Industrial Revolution, we had already discussed. Transformation of production system from domestic system of production to factory system of production. Industrial Revolution led to abundance of production, surplus production in England. So the British merchants were looking for new markets. So British merchants put forward some of their demands before the British Parliament. The first demand was that East India Company's monopoly to trade in India should be ended and all the British merchants should be allowed to go and trade in India. The second demand was that import of textile, silk and other handicrafts from India to England should be banned because Indian goods were fine. They were better as compared to the machine-made goods of England. The third demand was that heavy excise duty should be imposed on the Indian goods, that means the goods which were imported from India to England. And because of this, because of the demand of this British merchants on calico, the excise duties were increased from 18% to 67%. So England's market for Indian manufacturers was closed. Indian manufacturers' trade ruined in Europe. Due to continental blockade of Napoleon. Napoleon was a statesman, a French statesman. He had established continental blockade. That means the trade of other European countries with England was banned as India was also a colony of England. So the trade between India and other European countries were also banned. The British Chamber of Commerce put forward some demands before the British Parliament. They were as follow. You will understand these demands. First was the company's monopoly to trade in India should be ended. Already this was a demand put forward by the British merchants. Even the British Chamber of Commerce wanted that all private British merchants should be allowed to go and trade in India. The second demand was that Indian economy should be open to the private merchants of England. All should have equal right to trade in India. The third demand was that duty on imported goods should be lowest. That means the goods which were coming from England to India, the excise duty should be low so that the goods can be sold at a cheap rate in India. Duties on homemade products should be more. The things which were sent from India to England or the imported goods in England from India, the excise duty on those goods should be high. And last demand was that development of transport and communication should be there in order to enhance trade in India. In order to accept the demands put forward by British Chamber of Commerce, two laws were made in the British Parliament, known by the Charter Act of 1813 and the Charter Act of 1833. The Charter Act of 1813 declared that the East India Company's monopoly exclusive right to trade in India was ultimately ended. It also ensured that India was thrown open to private merchants of England. That means anybody, any British merchant or investor has a right to come and trade in India. Then Charter Act of 1833 was passed. According to that, increased excise duty on imported goods from India. That means the goods which were coming to England from India, the excise duty was increased, and the goods which were coming in India from England, the excise duty was reduced, so that the British goods can compete with the Indian goods. And ultimately, the door of the Indian manufacturer to the British market was ended. Both these acts, the Charter Act of 1813 and the Charter Act of 1833, resulted in deindustrialization of Indian economy. Now, we will understand what was the result of deindustrialization of economy. Deindustrialization means that there was no setting up of industries. Government did not show any interest in setting up of big industries in India. There was total negligence of industrialization in India. So when deindustrialization of Indian economy was done by the British government, it means that no export of Indian goods. Indian merchants had no place in the British market. Indian market was flooded with the British goods. On the contrary, the Indian market was full of the British goods. In every sector, the British good was in abundance in India. Investment on cloth in Dhaka was reduced. Dhaka, which was known as the Manchester of cloth industry, the investment was reduced because people started buying the machine made British cloth instead of Indian cloth. Market for raw material and selling finished goods. So India became a market who used to send the raw material from India to England, and where machine made goods of England used to come to sell in the Indian market. And home charges were also taken from India. Home charges, that means the salaries, the pensions of the British officials were paid out of the fund of India, and also the land revenue was also sent from India. So because the British were now interested in taking more home charges, so they also took interest in the revenue policy of the Indian peasants. British increased the land revenue after getting the Diwani rights in 1765. Diwani means right to collect taxes. Warren Hastings was the first governor general who introduced the bidding system. Bidding system means that anybody who gave the highest bid was given the right to collect the land revenue, and the zamindars were deprived of their right of holding the land. But it failed. So British introduced three major land revenue systems in India, known as the permanent settlement, Rayotwadi system, and the Mahalwadi system. And about these three revenue settlements, we will discuss in our next session. I hope you have understood till here. With the help of this explanation and internet, you are advised to make note of this topic. Thank you.